Good morning. It's Wednesday, November 12th, 2014. This is Tech Talk Today, episode 90. I'm standing here across from what appears to be a time traveler. Hi there, Ange. Good morning to you.
Hello.
So you got to come over here. I got to turn on the drone cam for a second. Get over here. So those of you listening at home, I'm going to do a little theater of the mind for you. Ange today is wearing a 50s getup. With even the glasses and everything, because it's 50s day at our son's school. It's 50s day because it's their first 50 days.
Yeah, it's the 50th day of school today.
Well, it's an exciting day, not just because you're dressed up in a 50s outfit, but it's also hashtag Comet Landing Day, everybody. And people are pretty excited this morning about it. In fact, on Twitter, just a little bit ago, Hal9000 just tweeted out, at ESA Rosetta texted me this selfie saying, "I'm on a comet, bitches." And there's a picture of it right there. Landed on a comet. I guess they're having some harpoon issues at the moment. But I don't know. It's kind of exciting day today here. And it's also super, super, super cold out. And we have a lot of big news to get into as well. So to help us break through all of it is our awesome Mumble Room. Time appropriate greetings, Mumble Room.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Good morning. Morning.
What? Yeah, yeah. Be up, yo.
Happy
well,
science.
Yeah, no kidding, right? So are you guys, did you follow the whole comet landing thing? The live stream and all that? No? Nobody did?
What? I missed that.
It wasn't working.
This is my headphones.
Yeah, I know. There was like, they couldn't show the actual landing.
Yeah. That's convenient.
Staged, Ange says.
Yeah.
Suspicious.
He knew.
So we'll, but that's happening right now as we record the show. We'll continue to follow it, and it's pretty neat. The picture I saw was really weird looking. And you can follow the latest stuff at ESA_Rosetta or hashtag Comet Landing on the Twitters. There's a lot of people talking about it right now.
Where is it landing?
On a comet.
Oh, I thought a comet was coming here.
No, they went and sent
end of the
it there.
World.
It went there just, you know, and so we're going to just set up like a tent.
That is awesome.
It is. It is, yeah. Camping.
Let's start digging underground right now.
Yeah, let's see if there's any oil on that comet. That'd be great. All right, let's get into a quick follow-up story from yesterday. Gnome and Groupon are hugging it out right now as we speak. Things are not as bad as they once seemed. Groupon has dropped the trademark applications that sought to use the term Gnome for a point-of-sales tablet it released in May. Now, the nonprofit Gnome Foundation has raised, what was it, Eric? Did you say $100,000?
It's over $100,000. Last I checked, it was $107,000.
Wow. Wow.
That is a lot of blow money. Now, I'm sure it's going to go to help furthering the Gnome desktop. And as a Gnome user, I'm pretty excited about that. I'm totally okay with my money going towards the Gnome development. In fact, when I made the donation, my hope was that this would get dropped and that that's where it would go.
Well, I'm sure they still had some fees that needed to be covered.
Oh, for sure,
so,
right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, exactly. It's not like the money's going to go nowhere. They're going to use the money, one. And two, I'm sure their lawyers did require fees.
And, you know, Groupon is, they had 28 trademark applications pending on this thing. 28. So, pretty intense.
I don't understand how it got that far.
Yeah. I don't know. If it thinks it planned to file formal proceedings of 10 of Groupon's applications would have been on December 3rd. So it was going to happen quick. But it looks like things are calming down. Hey, things are not calming down for SSL, especially this time. Hey, everybody, it's Windows users' turn. Oh, that's right. A potentially catastrophic, I should say, bug is biting all versions of Windows.
Oh, my gosh.
You like that pun?
Well, it's just crazy.
What? That the bug is biting?
It's just...
Yeah. Oh, for sure, right?
It literally makes me flash back to when I lived with my mom and we were running, you know, Windows 98.
Yeah.
And we'd have to sit there and wait for it to do something.
And 95 and stuff like that. It was always a problem where, yeah. Microsoft has disclosed this vulnerability. They say people need to update, like, right away. It's patch Tuesday was yesterday. So
that is crazy. Does that do it automatically? Do they at least have it done automatically background?
Some users do.
Oh. Depends on the setup.
Is it the default?
Mine updated it last night, yeah, and it then reset afterwards.
So here's what's interesting. It affects S channel. It's Microsoft's secure channel. It's a security component that implements the secure sockets layer and transport layer of the TLS protocol. So according to this Microsoft advisory, it affects their implementation of TLS, essentially. The failure to properly filter specifically formed packets makes it possible for attackers to execute attack code of their choosing by simply sending malicious traffic to a Windows server.
Wow.
Yeah. They mainly focused on Windows servers because it could affect IIS servers that are listening to web connections and things like that. But essentially, any Windows box that's listening for remote connections, they say, could be vulnerable. They say if the user installs software that listens on a port, then that machine would be vulnerable, according to the researcher. As an example, if they run Windows 7, but they install an FTP server on it that accepts connections from the outside or a web server on a client, they are vulnerable. Tuesday's disclosure now means, by the way, that every major version of the TLS stack that is in production, you got Apple's Secure Transport that was in iOS, GNU TLS, OpenSSL, NSS, and now Microsoft's S Channel, have all had crippling major vulnerabilities this year.
That's crazy. And then you combine that with all the credit card breaches and...
Yeah.
Or maybe it's because of Windows.
No, I don't think so. I like the idea of blaming them all on Windows. Yeah. No, it's just there's a lot more scrutiny on this stuff now, so it's a little bit of that.
Or maybe it was Obama.
And it's computational power is getting better. Like it's a whole storm of stuff.
Angela, you just nailed my uncle's theory. If there's a problem, you got to blame it on Obama. It's always Obama's fault.
Yeah.
I just closed the tab, Blaster. Hold on a second. Of course, links. So Blaster's asking for a link to the article. Links to everything we cover in every episode are always posted in the show notes once the show's posted online. But there you go. Chrome has this great just reopen tab feature.
Nice.
Of course, Firefox has that too. Hey, this is kind of neat. This could I like this idea a lot for parents. It's called Our Health. It's actually being developed for NASA, and it could be a total BS product. We're going to have to do a little bit of tech talk today, detective work here. But it promises to be an entire lab of medical tests in a portable device about the size of like a Nintendo DS or something.
It's about time.
It's amazing.
That's seriously.
And it uses this amazing technology where they you know, where like you would normally, you would pick your finger, you mm-hmm. would take a strip, you would put blood on that strip and then put it in a tester, right?
Yeah.
Well, this device, when you prick yourself, it has nano strips in it. And so it can get all of the different strip tests in one prick.
Yep.
And it's really neat. I want to play a little bit of the video for you, and then we'll decide if it's legit or not. Because you never know. These things could just be pie-in-the-sky promises.
Of all the things in this world, what is really most important to each and every one of us is our health. Far too often, being able to properly take care of yourself is simply out of reach. There are over 2 billion people on Earth that do not have proper medical care. We set out to fix that. We set out to create a device that allows you to diagnose yourself no matter where you are. So we developed a transformative technology that will do just that, called the Our Health. This will change forever how you take care of yourself and your loved ones. The Our Health is designed to democratize biomedical diagnostics and to give you hundreds of lab values from a single drop of blood with gold standard accuracy. It has an all-inclusive vitals patch that provides comprehensive, uninterrupted health readings all wirelessly. There are 3 instruments in the Our Health family: the Our Health 1 for research use, the Our Health X, and the X1 for medical.
Now, this isn't a crowdfunder. That's coming up later in the show. Funny enough, but I thought they put a pretty neat video together. They say they've worked with NASA, the Gates Foundation. Ideally, NASA wanted astronauts to have something they could take up with them and then test themselves up in space. Mm-hmm. I love the idea of this, but have we been promised this like 1,000 times? They call it blood to Bluetooth. How adorable is that?
Well, it depends, I think, on the range of tests that it does, you know? Because, I mean, why would you prick? I thought it was like a one-time use. You can find some things out about your genetics and history and what could possibly
it'll do,
happen.
So here's what you want to hear is a few of the things it can do.
Yeah.
HIV detection, vitamin D level detection.
Ooh, that's cool.
Various protein markers in the body, etc. Mm. They say next challenges, according to Chan, are making it more tests, scaling up production, and things like that. But HIV detection, vitamin D levels, and various protein markers are interesting.
That's not worth it.
But it's a beginning.
Yeah.
You know, here's the thing. I can see this tool being used by 2 people, by one type of person, that's hypochondriacs.
Yeah.
and the second one is that this is pretty much the new WebMD. You put a drop of blood in it, tells you you've got cancer.
And Chuck nailed me, though. What it is I just want a tricorder, guys. And I'm like, okay, build this, right? And then, like, in 10 years, build that into the freaking smartphone. Because, like, we have 3 kids. And, like, it's sometimes, like, is he sick tonight? why is he so melancholy? Why is he tired? Like, right. If I could just test him, and then my smartphone would tell me, yeah, he's got high levels, even if it was just like, yeah, his immune system's going crazy right now. Any of those things would be really helpful.
Good luck getting a child to submit to a blood prick.
Yeah, but the whole idea of this is quite interesting because it can give doctors statistical data over a longer period of time instead of just having a snapshot when you are at the doctor's.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Google will probably buy them.
Yeah.
And I'm sure insurance companies will absolutely love these devices.
Oh, that's a creepy thought.
That's
yeah.
Oh, what do you think?
Be sure to bring in your tricorder at your next visit.
Or like, Progressive has this deal right now where if you put their GPS tracker in your ODB2 port and you drive around.
ODB2 port?
You know that thing like I put my little
diagnostic thing?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So if you put their, they have like some great name for it, like Progressive Companion or something like that, and you put that in there, they'll give you a discount, but then they get to audit all of your braking, all of your acceleration, all of that stuff. But you get a discount on your bill if you do it for now.
Yeah, but then when you get in an accident, they're going to be like, yeah, it was totally your fault. We have the records.
Exactly.
We're not going to cover it. Like,
exactly.
Regardless
not worth it.
Of what the police say.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah, because they have the data. Data doesn't lie.
Yeah, the thing that they lack in that is unless they hit another Progressive customer with a companion, it's only one side.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I
that
agree.
Actually happened to my parents, like, several, like, before I was born, my dad got into a crash, and the other guy's insurance happened to be their insurance. It was a nightmare, they said.
Well, before we move on to the next story, I just wanted to also mention, if they could make this thing more robust, for like developing worlds where they have some smartphones, they have some connectivity, but they don't have a lot of doctors, this could scale doctors up in a big way. Like I had a client who was one of the leading robotic...
brain surgeons?
Yeah.
Neurosurgeons.
Because there was areas of just the United States where they had connectivity, but they didn't have any doctors that knew how to operate on the brain like that. So they were so desperate for it that they were doing telecommuting surgery. So maybe this would be a great way to do telecommuting diagnostics where only the really sick would go and have to find a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see. Right now, it does seem a little smoke and mirrors.
Well, you know, one thing in this area that we have is that you pay $20, no copay. It's just a $20 fee to, like, the Franciscan Health Services, and you tell it your symptoms, and a doctor will go through your symptoms and diagnose you.
Mm.
And it's that way you don't have to actually go into the urgent care or something if something's wrong, and then they could go ahead and write a prescription from there or what have you, or tell you need to go in.
All right, next story. YouTube Music is launching. It's a real thing in a couple of weeks. I just wanted to follow up on it real quick. I don't know if anybody cares a lot. Do you care?
I was on that show.
Yeah, I know.
When we talked about it. So what is it that they're offering?
Well, we don't know the details yet, but the big holdup... Oh, hi there, Crazy Mouse Cursor. The big holdup was, I guess, one of these record labels. Merlin is the record label. They represent about 20,000 indie music labels, and they were the ones holding out. Remember there was that big hoopla about indie, this was their labels that were going to get pulled, quote-unquote. That was going to be the effect of it. And so this move now means you'll have ad-free streaming options with their music or streaming options with ads. And you'll probably eventually see a companion app that's just focused on music.
And it's not music. It's music videos, right?
I don't know. I mean, they call it a music service, but you would have to think it's got to be with music videos.
So bear with me here. So if YouTube is going to do music videos streaming, that kind of coincides with the Facebook in the future being all video.
Zuckerberg saying in five years gonna be all video.
Yeah.
You know, I guess it's not uncommon that a lot of people just like load up a YouTube playlist and just listen to music videos off of YouTube. Like that's how it never crossed my mind because the audio quality is so bad. But some people just don't care.
Yes. Yeah.
But if they could work on that, I don't know.
You know, I'm noticing that go ahead.
I was going to say, most portable devices, music, the quality isn't going to make much difference when you're listening on the move.
Yeah. I suppose. I don't...
In a car, it might.
Yeah, I don't know. Eric, would you pay for a YouTube Music subscription service?
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't either. I just like do a playlist and set that going.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Yep, I like the music on my phone, and I play that.
Yeah. Chat room is asking, and a lot of people are really excited this morning about .NET going open source. That who knows what exactly that means. So I'm waiting to kind of get more. It sounds like some of the stuff's going to be MIT licensed. That's kind of interesting. But I think I'm not going to talk about it today, but we'll probably look. I'm keeping an eye on that story. I want to wait to give it a couple of days and see if we get more information where we're going to see all of the code drop, what all of it's going to, if it's all going to be one license or a bunch of little individual licenses, if we're going to see some development like IDE tools go along with that and things like that. But yeah, that is a big story developing today.
What is .NET? Is it literally .NET URLs?
No. Oh, no. So there is a, well, it could, I think they mean their C# development language.
That's exactly what
there's
it means.
A lot of tools around this, like this development language that Microsoft has that they call like .NET is an overarching branding of all of these tools that are in this C# development.
I see.
Area, and you I don't know if the, they like. I know like some of them like is components and tools of .NET, but yeah, go ahead, Eric.
Well, earlier this year we actually did see C# go open source, so it was only a matter of time before all of .NET.
Yeah, and that's kind of I think. It's almost like the other shoe is dropping. But what I don't see, what I don't understand is I don't know if is dot anyway. So I'm following the story, but I have a lot of questions. So I'm not talking about it. I know it has the words open source in it. So people are asking me in the chat room over and over again if I'm going to talk about it. But just because it has the words open source doesn't mean we don't wait for the full story to develop and then talk about it.
Yep.
So just some clarification. Plan. WizardGed does post in the chat room that .NET is an API. So that answers that question.
And to be honest with you, it probably is a conversation better for Coda Radio.
Absolutely.
So, it's come up like 30 times in the chat room. So let's move on to our Kickstarter of the week. This one's kind of interesting, and I picked this one because of you.
Okay.
Because I'm worried about your safety.
Oh, great.
Yeah. It's called Drive Safe. It's just Drive. Safe messaging and drive. Okay.
And driving, okay.
Are you ready? You ready for this? Okay, I'm going to play the video. Here's our vital stats.
Wait, I feel like it might involve the no phone.
No, although that would probably be the safest. This is more for like you because like you have to stay in communication while you're driving. Like that's you.
Okay.
You do,
okay.
Right?
Yeah.
And so right now, 89 backers, they got 15,000 of a goal of 88,000 with 17 days left to go. So we have time. It's tight. All right, but here you go, Ange. Here is Drive, and this could keep you safe, but in touch while on the road. Are you excited?
Our phones help us stay connected and be productive everywhere we go. The one place that sees us to be true is in our cars. It was really a breakthrough to design something that integrates so well into a car.
Voice message from Paige.
I'll let you go, Paige.
Text from Danny. Looking forward to tonight.
Drive aims to help you stay connected while driving. It reads out all your messages and notifications and allows you to respond to them when possible.
Hey, what was the address again?
It's the first product designed that truly simplifies the connection between drivers and their phone.
Notice how she's using her hands when she talks to it, or he does.
Stop believing. Giants are up 2-0.
I was part of a very small team at Apple that worked very hard on improving the acoustic front end of Siri. But I have to admit, speech recognition is a very difficult technology. It doesn't seem to personally work for everyone. People speak in many different languages, in different intonations, and it's very hard to optimize and perfect that experience for everyone. I wanted to avoid that frustration in a car environment. The other challenge when designing Drive was the user experience. We knew the interaction had to be simple, intuitive, and most importantly, safe. Every feature on Drive was designed with a purpose. Drive is controlled by simply extending your fingers while your hands remain on the wheel. This works by pulsing infrared beams on the left and right side of the unit. Drive's 3-microphone system forms a pickup beam to target your voice.
What do you want to say to Danny?
What was that song from last night?
Seems like an increase in hand cancer.
Oh, jeez, Ange.
They can hear you exactly as you recorded things without the frustration of speech recognition. The impact it creates to people's lives is what drove me to create this product.
All right.
We need to support in making Drive a reality.
So the guy helped develop Siri speech recognition.
Is simple.
It snaps right onto your dash there. So it's easy snap on.
Seamless interaction with the driver and the excellent recording quality.
It's got a 3-mic recording system. It integrates with your phone, reads your feeds, does your messaging.
All right, so here's a couple things that I initially think of.
All right, what do you think?
I'm going to turn, and it's going to be like sending message to.
I think you activate the UI, so you voice prompt it, you wake it up, and then you use your hands in the air, and you sort of like do gestures, okay. Sort of like, what's that, a Minority Report style, to move through the interface. And as you move through the interface, the icons on it change, and it's down by your dash, so it's by your speedometer and all of that. So you don't look beyond your speedometer and your...
Yeah, I don't know. The other thing is that I'm pretty sure that 10 and 2 are not the proper hand positions now for driving.
That's the exact design flaw I was just thinking about.
Yeah.
You're no longer supposed to have it at 10 and 2 because of airbags.
It's supposed to be 4 and 8.
4 and 8, that's correct.
My wife's Italian, so she'd get too many false positives.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, and here's the other thing.
So is my wife.
Here's the other thing. So I like this a lot for suckers like me who are stuck in vehicles that don't have any technology in them at all. This seems appealing to me, but a lot of you that have like cars where you can hook your phone up to the stereo and you have LCD screens built in, you already get a lot of this stuff. You got controls in your steering wheel like a jerk. And all of this stuff. Meanwhile, us animals are driving around with our Fred Flintstone vehicles. This, to me, seems kind of appealing. But, however, then I think to myself, let's be honest. The next car I get, or the next vehicle I do get, is probably going to have like 85, 90% of this built in.
Yeah.
That's the flaw, in my opinion.
Sorry, not only that, there's a lot of vehicles you couldn't even mount this thing in. I mean, just the way the steering wheel breaks for the tilt, or you might have the hazards on top of it, it's just not going to work.
I don't think that would work in most Toyotas because that spot in the dash isn't there. Because they moved the speedometer to more of a central location, so you always have your heads up.
I wonder if maybe a better approach for these guys wouldn't be to partner with car manufacturers.
I think Rikai, who doesn't drive, makes the funniest comment. So you snap it into your dash, and then it blocks some of the instruments?
No, Rikai, no.
For instance, my odometer in my...
So I think you wouldn't have to put it there, right? You could probably put it anywhere on the dash, I would think. But,
yeah.
This video shows the installation. You can see it where... So you see there's the instrumentation, right? And then they'll snap it in, and it snaps in below. It's got a low profile. So it snaps in right
there. That's not so bad. I thought...
Like, I guess on some cars it might block some of it.
I thought this was going to be the like the Google Glass thing where you'd be able to see through the
windshield
thing. Oh, like
a heads-up projection?
Yeah, but... Ooh. Which I think is... No, which I think... Oh. There's a difference between looking at something up close and something far. If you're focusing on what's up close, you cannot see what's far.
But I could have, like, Plex up on my windshield.
Oh my gosh,
while I'm
no.
Oh, no. Bad.
But I gotta catch up on 24. All right.
Nope, not while you're driving. Nope.
So is this a resounding no vote?
Feel
bad.
I'm going to throw a no vote.
I feel bad.
I would say yes.
Here's the thing. I have something cheaper. It's called a windshield mount.
No.
All right, wait. Lionhead. Go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say no because, the way technology is going at the moment, smartphones will do voice and you can do everything with that this can do.
Well, the argument is the smartphone microphone setup isn't ideal for a car environment where this is. So it's just, it augments your car function. But Lionhead, you said you would get it?
Oh, yes. I drive a 93 Audi 80s, 90 in the States, and that has basically nothing.
Yep.
I have a mount for my phone, but to have this closer to my mouth in a noisy car, that would be wonderful.
I feel like a monster. I'm a technologist who drives a Stone Age vehicle, and I feel like a monster. So this feels like it would bring me, this would be like it would give me something. Like, it would keep me happy, but that's fine. Maybe I have other problems I need to address.
Well, like, Chris, you've seen my setup. I have a windshield mount going on with my phone near the dash.
Yep.
It can pick me up just fine from right there. So,
that's true.
It's not too bad. And my car is not made for these newer devices.
That's true. You know, I do dictation with my phone mounted on the windshield. It actually works okay.
Yeah, same here.
Well, yeah, and you mostly listen to content. Once you've got the content going, you don't really need to mess with it much. So
yeah, but sometimes, like, I got to respond to a message or look something up. Yeah, I don't know. You're right. What if I got business to attend to?
If you were a traveler, more of a traveler.
What if I got all these ladies sending me messages I got to respond to?
Well, maybe.
All right. Any final thoughts? Yeah, go ahead.
I've got a 1995 T100 truck, and I just used my same Sennheiser headphones and my mobile phone with an audio adapter. I don't want a vehicle that has outdated technology that was discontinued a year before, because then I've got a bunch of blank panels and my tablet sitting on the dashboard.
Yeah, I agree. That's one of the reasons why I haven't really been too tempted to pull the trigger on anything too fancy either, because it feels like temporary old technology lock-in. By the time they've got it on the manufacturing floor, the next thing's already in development.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure headphones while driving is illegal.
Yeah,
it's here, at least.
I mean, there are some that are approved, but there are some that are not approved. And it really depends on the design and everything.
If you get pulled over, just tell them you're listening to Jupiter Broadcasting and you're fine. they'll let you go.
That's right, because they love that.
Yeah. Oh, a podcast? Yeah, that's fine. You're clear to
you're
go,
good,
sir.
You're good.
Here, I'll hold up traffic for you while you merge. So it works out really well. All right. So, we have been doing all week long something kind of special. I don't know why. Actually, it's not very special. I just found a lot of great clips, and I'm an old person, and it reminded me. I know people hate it when I say that, but I just, these old commercials take me back. So it's Intel Week here on Tech Talk Today. And I picked this one out just for you, Ange, and it kind of fits in with our timeline. You and I were just getting to know each other when this commercial hit the air.
And just before that, remember to go to patreon.com and support Tech Talk Today.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Yeah, we haven't had anybody this week do that. In fact, we dropped one.
Yeah, we're a 404 error now.
Oh, my gosh, we've dropped two.
We're at 404.
We are?
Last I checked, yeah.
Oh, so we're down two.
That's okay.
Well, we need your help. Patreon.com/today and support the Jupiter Broadcasting Network. And thank you, everyone who does that. If you get a little enjoyment and value out of this show or any of the shows on the Jupiter Broadcasting Network, that's a great way to support us. Also, you can go to the subreddit, techtalktoday.reddit.com, and contribute that way. Or show up live. That's good, too.
All right, let's see this old biznass that was going on when we were dating.
Get ready to get funky, Ange.
The Pentium processor with Intel MMX technology gives you full sound, smooth video, and rich colors. So it's no wonder the technicians who add this technology walk with a little extra spring in their step. Well, you can't tell.